All right, in my previous video, I spoke about why Expo 2020 is actually a good thing for Dubai or UAE. In this video, I'm going to give you 21 reasons why Expo 2020 or Expo 2021 is going to be a failure. Okay, and I'll put the timestamps down below for each and every point. Give me your analysis based on each and every point. On the timestamps, which one do you think I'm right? Which one do you think I'm wrong? Because, you know, maybe there is something I need to know which you know better. So we'll keep the conversation open. So let's move on because there are 21 points. The first one is the obvious one. The first reason is the pandemic. Now, we all know what has happened because of the pandemic. The nations are on shutdown. Australia is in a lockdown. US has, you know, shut out anybody from UAE or Africa coming in because of the new coronavirus. UK is in lockdown. France, other European countries are in fear. So the first obvious reason is the pandemic. And as long as you don't have people coming in or, you know, not allowed to leave, I mean, it becomes a big headache. On top of that, just imagine, you have to stay 14 days quarantined in a hotel. Who'd want to do that? That itself is a headache. And then if you have connecting flights or you have to have a stopover, I mean, that involves you being quarantined in that place and it's a big hassle. So the first obvious reason is the pandemic by itself and the complications that it causes. So that's the first reason. The second reason is the result of the pandemic, that is the recession. Now, you know, when pre-COVID, everyone was working, everyone was earning money, even though there was a slight recession, but still people were earning money, okay? You had bank loans, which you could get easily, multiple credit cards, and if nothing else, you could at least go to work and earn some money and, you know, work multiple jobs. I know quite a number of people who, even though they have multiple credit cards, they could go to, you know, multiple jobs. They could work for one job in the morning, do some freelance work in the afternoon, evening, take a dead-end night shift. So there's always work. But now because of the pandemic, there is no work. Like, There's no work. People can work. People want to work. But then, because nobody is eating in restaurants, nobody is buying anything, people are afraid. There is no demand for goods and services. And so companies are saying, see, listen, when we have business, we'll call you. Until then, there's no work. So now a person who wants to work and earn money has to sit at home and do nothing. And, you know, when you're not earning anything, you don't want to spend anything. And then on top of that, even if you're not spending anything or not earning anything and you're at zero, but you will have bills to pay, water, electricity, food. So then you go in a minus. So in this frame of mind, who wants to go for an expo? Who wants to go for an outing? Who wants to, you know, spend money? And Expo 2020 is not a necessity. It is more of a luxury. It is more of a, okay, let me enjoy. I have extra money. Let me enjoy myself. But when you're under stress and duress, you don't want to go and enjoy yourself. You want to sit and think, how do I earn money? So the second point is recession. Point number three is UAE's scandals. Now, what has happened is, I don't know whether it is UAE's enemies UAE's enemies trying to put UAE down or what it is, or maybe the ruler of Dubai, his powers are not what it used to be. We have everything from his daughter to Princess Latifa to UK severing ties with Sheikh Mohammed to the money laundering, to the criminals who are there in UAE, to the doubts that Denmark put in terms of the testing. See, all this adds up to the reputation of the place and it creates negative publicity. It creates a bad name. Always keep in mind, we live in a day and age where when you're successful, when you have a good name, everyone wants to associate with you. But when you start having a bad name, people don't want to associate with you because they don't want people looking at you. Oh, he went and associated with that person or this country or this company. And then you'll get the law enforcement agencies. Let's keep an eye on this guy. So nobody wants all that. So point number three is the scandals that Dubai, not UAE, Dubai has faced over the past few months or since the past few years, which has very lately happened. Before it was very tight-lipped, but now there's so much of bad press and bad coverage that is going out. So when you have somebody whose reputation is in question, not many people want to associate with that product, service or person. So that's point number three. Point number four is the relationship of UAE, but now with Israel. And that itself is a big, big question. And when you're talking of Israel, US also comes in the picture. Now, until the pre-COVID days, UAE was, you know, part of the Middle East. And even if they didn't agree with Qatar, okay, fine, they were part of the Middle East. Now, all of a sudden, to get into the good books of Trump's administration, not US, Trump, okay? They decided because Trump wanted maybe to leave with a lasting legacy or, you know, get some Nobel Peace Prize or make Harold Kushner, who is his son-in-law, as a puppet. They agreed to whatever US wanted. US as in sense of Donald Trump. And rumor mill has it that UAE wanted to get some seat of power in the White House or in Congress, especially with the sale of arms, okay, to Saudi and UAE. And obviously, you know that UAE has been using Israel spyware. Just go to Jazeera, Al Jazeera news channel, and there you see, can your phone spy on you? You'll see how the spyware, which Israel created, Pegasus, is so advanced. You don't even have to click on anything. You just switch on your phone. It will spy on you and it'll give your location, your data about you, everything. So there is no way you can keep things hidden. Remember when Jeff Bezos met up with King Salman and his phone was hacked? And after that, do you think anybody would trust King Salman? No. So what happens is when you have a situation where you know, you're being associated with spyware, spying, you're being associated with Donald Trump. Before there was unity in the Muslim country, but now you're friends with Israel and you've given up on all the practices that your father, your forefathers had in UAE. So then, it does create a new set of challenges. Now that Trump is not there, this relationship itself is going to cause a lot of problems, okay? Because Biden has halted the sale of arms to UAE and Saudi. And then Israel is nobody's friend. Israel only cares about Israel. They don't consider UAE equals. So now UAE is left in a limbo. What do you do? So that's point number four, which indirectly will affect Expo. Point number five. This relationship with Israel has further escalated this problem, and that is the instability in the Middle East region. You know, before you had UAE, Saudi, Qatar, Bahrain, Oman all unified together. Okay? They were all together. It was called the Middle East. It was like a Middle East bloc. OPEC. They were all together. And strength comes in numbers, and especially when you're unified together. But now have a look at the unity. There's no unity. Qatar is one side, and you have UAE, Saudi on the other side. There is absolutely no more unity. And now, even though they have made peace, okay, King Salman welcomed the Qatari Emir, Tamim. Fine, you might give him a hug and all that, but nobody's going to forget those wounds. Nobody's going to forget what you did. People don't forget. My simple logic is, if someone hurt you, your family, insulted you, tried to destroy you, harmed you, and then after 3-4 years, just came and give you a hug and say, you know, let's make peace and friendship, are you going to forget all that injustice that they did? No. And UAE didn't have a choice. When Saudi said, okay, let's make peace, UAE also had to follow suit. All the pride, all the ego, all the arrogance that they showed, gone, right? So, the point number 5 is the instability in the region. If all the countries were united, I would say there was a chance of making Expo 2020 at least a success, because all the neighboring countries will contribute. But now, when there's no stability and each country is looking out for themselves, you host a party, you host an event, out of formality, they might say, okay, fine, we'll participate. But they are not going to go out of the way to make it a success. So that's point number 5. Point number 6 is the UAE and Abu Dhabi relationship. Never in the history of UAE has Dubai and Abu Dhabi been so far apart. In fact, right from the time Dubai started with all the, the expansion of the islands and making the railways and, the tram and all those mega projects. Ever since Sheikh Mohammed started being overly ambitious, Abu Dhabi and Dubai have not looked eye to eye. And everyone knows there was that tension. But it became back to worse after, first they gave them a loan, which, after they gave them a loan, okay, fine. One part is sorted out. But now when, always remember this, when someone gives you money, your kind of position of respect and power goes down. And Abu Dhabi had given Sheikh Mohammed a massive sum of money, huge amount. And that is why, to show Abu Dhabi controls Dubai, they changed the name of Burj Dubai to Burj Khalifa. The branding of Dubai became Khalifa. And it's so symbolic. I mean, just look at it. The tallest tower, the most iconic tower of Dubai, that shows Dubai's towering success, Dubai's ability to rise to the top or go reach to the skies, is called Khalifa. So it was like, the crude joke that was, the biggest erection in the middle of Dubai is Khalifa. So, what can you say? Then after that began, Dubai was not able to pay back. And then bidding for Expo 2020, which I don't think Abu Dhabi was very keen. That is why you see Sheikh Mohammed right in the front. And then after they got it, this COVID crisis, just look at Abu Dhabi. Abu Dhabi has its own set of rules. Dubai has its own set of rules. Abu Dhabi says no in and out and testing is mandatory. Dubai says, no, we are open. We have conquered COVID. Come anytime you want. So when two parties are speaking two different languages, that means there is no unity, right? So the unity that was there between Dubai and Abu Dhabi, the two key players, is no longer there. And everyone can sense that tension. So now when you have Expo 2020, which Abu Dhabi was not very keen, on top of that you have Dubai making a mess and destroying UAE's economy by opening it up to tourists and bringing people, and COVID infections are going up. Obviously, Abu Dhabi is not going to be very supportive towards the Expo 2020. It's going to be like, fine, I am not going to be against you, but I'm not going to support you as well. So that is point number six. Point number seven. Now, this is in regards to leadership of Sheikh Mohammed. Okay. Now, once upon a time, Sheikh Mohammed was like he was like, he had that image that he was infallible. You know, he could never fail. Whatever Sheikh Mohammed touches turns to gold. He had that that brawn, rough, tough image where, you know, anything he would take on, he would succeed. There was always a thing that Sheikh Mohammed's vision, whatever he touches turns to gold. And he was right. In so many ways, he was right. See, you have Dubai Internet City, a runaway success. Dubai Media City, again a success. You have the transformation of Dubai from a desert to a business hub, again a success. Jabal Ali Free Zone, again a success. The property market, where people made millions, some of them even made billions. All a runaway success of Sheikh Mohammed. Dubai being put on the international map. It was Sheikh Mohammed. Where once upon a time, Dubai was just a desert. Now everyone was literally thinking, how can I come to Dubai? How can I stay in Dubai? How can I visit Dubai? This is all because of Sheikh Mohammed. Nobody else deserves this credit, you know. So there's only one person who deserves credit for this, and this is Sheikh Mohammed. So credit should be given where credit is due. And Sheikh Mohammed is the reason why Dubai is so successful until now. But along with what he has done well, there are areas which he has totally messed up, and this is the problem. Sometimes his failures overshadow everything else. In fact, his failures are still there. I've said it so many times over, I don't want to go too much into detail. The Palm 2 and 3, failure. The World Islands, putting sand in the water, failure. Al Maktoum International Airport, such a massive one, failure. Dubai Logistics City, failure. Dubai District, failure. All the Falcon City and Bawardi City, 10 kilometer long hotels, failure. Even this, Dubai was involved so much into racing and horse racing after they got caught with the doping scandal. Again, that itself is a failure for Dubai's brand. And Dubai's gamble of aggressive expansion, and then when the market collapsed, unable to pay its loans, that again is a failure. So when you have all these, there's a big question. The question is his leadership. Can he handle the country? Can he handle the economy? Can he bounce back from all these missteps that he took? It is like that SoftBank guy. Once upon a time, everything he would bet on, from Alibaba to all other ventures, was a success. One gamble he took, that was WeWork, ruined every single thing that he did. So people definitely question you, you know. So the next point, that is point number seven, is questionable leadership. Point number eight is the loans. Dubai has yet to pay $21 billion. Okay? Now, officially, unofficially, that is the figure. So, when will you pay? Let's say, for example, let's not look at Dubai. Let's not look at a emirate. Let's look at a human being. Let's say I'm a guy. I'm very successful. I've, made so many business success. But then after that, after a certain point, whatever business I undertook was a failure. And then I took loans to make it a success. It was still average. But then I failed to pay the loans. And now I have 21 billion, which I've unpaid. Do you think anyone is going to trust me? People are going to say, see, Loy, listen, I don't mind believing in you, but first you pay off those loans, then we don't mind doing business. You have not paid the loans, and you're still talking big about vision and new business. Nobody is going to buy, nobody is going to believe. So the next point is the unpaid loans. You know, it's like your track record speaks. And the best example I can give here is M. Night Shyamalan, yeah, that director. When he directed that movie with Bruce Willis, I can't get the name, Sixth Sense, everyone said he's going to be the next Spielberg and he's a legend and he's going to be great. And then he came out with Unbreakable, which was still decent. Then he came out with Signs, which was okay. And from there, it was nothing but decline, just decline, decline, and it went back to worse. To the point where today, if anyone takes his name, it's a joke. He can't save his name and his legacy because he has had a string of flops. Same thing with Sheikh Mohammed. See, Sheikh Mohammed had incredible success in the past, but it's not the past people will look at. It's the immediate, the present. And the present doesn't look very good, no? So this is not me cooking up a story. This is fact. So I think it comes down to the unpaid loans, which is a big, you know, thorn at the backside of UAE. And this is a reason why Expo 2020 is a big question. Point number 9, the bad news. Once upon a time, you know, you didn't have Google, you didn't have social media, you didn't have Al Jazeera. And, you know, Dubai had Gulf News, Khaleej Times, and they could print whatever they wanted and be positive about it. Everything was kept, you know, close and hidden. So those days they could hype up Dubai as wow. But ever since Al Jazeera came, it started exposing all the drawbacks and failures of UAE. Okay? And then on top of that, you had undercover journalists who started exposing UAE. And then on top of that, now you have today Facebook, you have Twitter, you have so many ways like WhatsApp, Signal, Telegram. You have people who can share news, and if they want fake news, they can spread fake news. If they want to create rumors, they can spread it. There's no way to stop it. So now what has happened is, all the years you try to keep a very clean image, now all of a sudden all the bad news is leaking out, and there's no way to stop it. It's impossible to control it. You can fool people once, but you can't fool them forever, right? So now what has happened is, this in itself, social media and other news outlets that can literally expose you, it's impossible to save your skin. Because always remember, good news versus bad news. People always remember the bad news. And good news versus bad news, the one that travels faster is always bad news. So that is point number 9. Point number 10, the reason why Expo 2021 will be a failure is the changing policies. Just have a look from January 2020. How many times UAE has changed its policies with regards to COVID, with regards to COVID testing, with regards to people, expatriates with their visas? How many times they changed? Literally every month they would come out with a new policy, they would come out with a new law, they would come out with a new requirement. At first they said, don't need to worry everyone, you know, even though there is COVID, your visas will be kept safe, don't have to worry, we will figure out a way. Next thing you know is, okay, for those who are not in the country, if you're not coming on time, your visas will expire. Then they came out, okay, if you cannot come in and your visa is expired, you'll have to pay a fine or you'll have to renew. Then they came out that, okay, you need mandatory testing or you can't come in. And then they had a website, you have to register. Then the website was not working. Then they came out with something else. See, every time when you come out with a new law, new requirement, new policy, people begin to wonder, like, what can we believe? What can we trust? It's like, think, for example, you and me are friends. And today I put a condition, okay, you have to pay me $10. Let's say, for example, I say you have to pay me $10 if you and I have to go out. But when you come with $10, I say, no, now you have to come with $15. Okay, then after some time I come and say, no, now you have to pay me $10 in the morning, $10 in the evening. And then I'm like, man, how many times do you keep changing your rules? What is the payment fee? And then next thing you know, I say, okay, listen, pay me 25 now. So you have to be a, you have to stick to one word. And the problem with Dubai is, one time they're saying this is a total lockdown. One time they're saying there's no lockdown. We are back in business. And then they come and say, no, now we have to lock down again. I mean, stick to one thing, no? Either focus on making money at the cost of health, or focus on health at the cost of making money. You can't have both the ways. Point number 11. I think this one is, it doesn't take any rocket science. See, when Dubai got Expo 2020, for the next 5 years or 4 years after getting Expo 2020, bidding for it, they started to have an advertising campaign that Expo is going to be on October 2020 or September or October 2020, and it's going to run for X number of months. Okay, so everyone was happy. They kept advertising, they kept bombarding people with messages, they kept making those plans, travel agencies, selling holidays, packages, building hotels. Everything was based on a deadline, 2020. Okay, October 2020. But then COVID took place in January. And then people were not sure, is it going to happen, not going to happen? Finally, they said, sorry, we'll have to cancel. Now, all the money, all the effort, all the planning that was for 2020 is now cancelled. Just imagine, whatever money, whatever advance, whatever you are paid, all cancelled. Now, obviously, you can get salvage some of it. But now the problem is, for the next year, you have one added year, extra year, where you have to market, where you have to sell, where you have to reconfirm tickets, where you have to do all the exercise all over again. This increases your cost. This increases your expense. Now, if before your budget was, okay, I achieve 100 million, and if I achieve 100 million, I break even. Now you have spent another, let's say, 50 million more. So now it is no more 100 million, it's 150 million, which you need to earn to cover the expenses. And on top of that, you have to achieve 150 million at one of the worst times in the history of mankind. There is COVID, there is recession, there is no business, people can't travel, nobody wants to invest, there is no money. I mean, could things get any more worse than this? So now what has happened is all the effort that they took before has gone. And now to break even, it's like the revenue targets have doubled. This itself is going to cause a massive, massive problem. Point number 12. Pretty sure you've heard of this, money laundering. Now, from B.R. Shetty's scandal to all the other scandals that were there, I think UAE's image really got hurt with the all the questions that US has put, the central bank, the financial institutions. In fact, I think the climax was B.R. Shetty, the most recognized, the most adored, the most admired, the most visible brand of UAE. One is Yusuf Ali and one is B.R. Shetty. Okay, Moopan and all that, fine, nobody talks much about them. But these two guys were at the top. And all of a sudden, when you have the most visible character who has been associated with the UAE, NMC, money, UAE money, UAE exchange, when itself being exposed as they had irregularities, that too with the international auditing firms, that opened a Pandora's box. And ever since, not only Al Jazeera but other news outlets have been slamming UAE for money laundering practices. And the international banking community has itself questioned. Because see, anyone with black money, if they come to UAE and they don't do anything illegal and they invest, there are no questions asked. So UAE has lost its reputation. Now, when the word money laundering is involved and you set up a shop, you open up a business in Dubai, obviously they're going to look, okay, this country is known for money laundering. Why did this celebrity or why did this businessman open a business in Dubai? Oh, maybe he is also into money laundering. So it's, you know, like they say, if everyone's drinking whiskey in a glass and you're drinking just iced tea, it looks like you're drinking whiskey, right? So point number 12 is the money laundering scandal. And that is why people don't want to associate. Point number 13, something that nobody has an answer to. Here's my question. After Sheikh Mohammed, who's going to lead the country? Is it Faza? Have a look at it. A few days ago, there was that celebration that Faza has been put in the leadership position for 13 years. It's so funny and it's so ironic. Faza has been in the leadership position for 13 years, but what has he done? Nothing. He has just been at the background. The only thing, if you ask me, the only thing Faza is known for is his poetry. He's good at writing poetry. He's good looking. He takes part in all these sporting events. He's good at skydiving. He's good at this X sports. One second. Yes, Ali. So Faza is known for all this. But what else is he known for? What else is anyone talking about? Like when you talk about Dubai and its achievements, it's always Sheikh Mohammed. Nobody knows what Faza is capable of. So that is why the question begets. Okay, fine. Sheikh Mohammed is there now, but now he's in his 70s. Once he dies, who's going to take over? And let's say, for example, Faza takes over. Nobody knows what kind of leader is Faza. And there are so many rumors swirling around that after Sheikh Mohammed is no more, maybe Abu Dhabi will take over. And then what happens to all the rules, regulations, agreements? Maybe Abu Dhabi will change everything. So after Sheikh Mohammed, the big question is, now what? And this is something people are very concerned, especially those who want to invest. And trust me when I say this, nobody wants to invest in a country where you're not sure what's going to happen next. Point number 14 is UAE having too many enemies. You know, in a previous point I said, no, that there was strength in unity. But now it's not only UAE not being united, it's UAE having enemies which it didn't have before. Like the Yemeni Houthi rebels. They have hurt and injured them so badly. They don't want anything got to do with each other. UAE and Qatar, they have burnt and destroyed the bridges. Now, even though they have said, okay, we make peace and all that, don't get fooled by the fact that, okay, just because they made peace, things are back to normal. No. Qatar is going to continue being independent away from UAE. Yes, maybe they'll fly over the airspace. Then another enemy of UAE is, I would say they are enemies of themselves. After using Israeli technology, Israeli spyware, how many countries are comfortable dealing with UAE? In United States itself, fine, they made friends with Donald Trump, but Biden's administration is not very close and comfortable with UAE. So when you have all these pressure points, all these people who don't wish UAE well, what do you do? And it takes two hands to clap. If they had been at peace with everyone like Oman, peace and not making any drama and you live your life, I live mine, it would have been fine. But UAE has stepped on a lot of people's toes. It has Iran to worry about. It has, especially after its peace with Israel, its tension between Iran and UAE is much more. It has Yemeni Houthis to worry about. And yes, indirectly, still the tension between Qatar, I don't think it is gone. And now after Biden took over, you have tensions in USA. So these factors come into play, and that is why that itself will affect Expo 2020. Point number 15 is, I think there are too many countries and too many people afraid to associate themselves with the UAE. They are afraid of investing in UAE. They are afraid of what might happen next. And it's not only just UAE, it is the current climate of COVID. So people are afraid to take any step. How many countries are afraid and because of which they are closing down their borders? how many financial institutions are clamping down on so many activities. In fact, you remember the GameStop, the trading? Where was this behavior before? It was non-existent. But today, left, right and center, the dynamics are changing everywhere. And this stems from fear. And this in itself will impact Expo 2020 because these are unprecedented times. Point number 16. They say, no, that story, King Without Clothes. Everyone knew it, but they acted like they didn't know it. Same thing with UAE. Everyone knows UAE is bankrupt. It has not paid its loans. Everyone knows Expo 2020 is a flop. Everyone knows that UAE is just holding Expo 2020 just for the sake of saving its pride and its ego. So just like the king was walking naked with no clothes, everyone knew it, but nobody was talking about it. In the same way, Expo 2020, everyone knows it's a flop, it's a failure, they're just doing it for the hell of doing it. But nobody can talk about it. So it's a sad fact, you know. Trust me when I say this. It's like everybody knows for a fact UAE is regretting that they even bid for Expo 2020. All right, and I don't have to say more than that. Point number 17 is Expo 2020 is now it's more of an ego project. It's not a project for the economy because it's not going to contribute anything to the economy. Advertising. There are much more cheaper ways to advertise. You can just book on Facebook and just run ads or Google or YouTube. But UAE has taken on this massive undertaking, which was nothing but an ego project right from day one. When Dubai bid for it, Dubai wanted to show we are capable of doing anything and everything. The sky is the limit, like sending a man to the moon. Okay. This is not something that is necessary. It was nothing but ego. And today, they have to execute this ego. Others, it's a matter of shame. Just imagine if they cancel Expo 2020. It's going to be not only a laughing stock, it's going to be like a black dot that is going to taint the legacy and leadership of Dubai itself. Oh, they bid for Expo 2020. They failed. So now they want to show that, oh, we bid, there was, you know, COVID-19, but still we succeeded. So now it's become a project of ego. Point number 18. Now, Expo 2020 was taken when? Before COVID came into existence. So it was a pre-COVID bet. It was a pre-COVID plan. Had Expo 2020, if they could bid for it today, trust me, they would say, I think it's better we wait because we do not know what is going to happen. So the project that was taken before this COVID, when did they bid for Expo 2020? They bid for Expo 2020 when the economy was doing very well, when they were booming, when they had a lot of money, when they were pretty successful. That was the time. Today, nobody would want to bid for Expo 2020. Trust me when I say this. If suppose today they bid for Expo 2020, if there was a bidding, no country would come forward. No country would say, okay, we'll bid for it. Why? Because it's a liability. It's a headache. How do you get people? How do you quarantine them? What are the testing? What are the procedures? Who's going to come? So Expo 2020 was worth it before COVID. But now that COVID has come, it's nothing but a loss-making initiative. Point number 19, the infrastructure. You see all those buildings, impressive buildings, lovely bridges and lovely roads. Okay, now if you go there, hardly anybody is using it. When Expo 2020 takes place, yes, there are going to be people are going to use them, there are going to be visitors. But after Expo gets over, who's going to use that place? Who's going to use the infrastructure? Who's going to use those roads, those bridges, those buildings, those offices? It's all going to be a waste of time. See, when you build an infrastructure that people use or normal people use, or it's being used on a day-to-day basis, that's worth investing in. But when you have an infrastructure that is built only for a particular festival or event, after the event gets over, nobody's going to use it. Best example I can give you is Chinese Olympics. You know, when China hosted the Olympics, the stadium, the infrastructure, it was so amazing, it was so beautiful. But after the Olympics, nobody used it. Check what happened with Brazil. They took loans of billions. They made these infrastructures, these swimming pools, these stadiums. Who's using them today? They're desolate. They're just total waste. The same thing with Dubai. I mean, Dubai is such a small place. Now they are overbuilding all these stuff. Who's going to use them once it's going to get over? So this in itself is a massive mammoth failure. You can't dismantle those buildings. You can't sell that infrastructure. What do you do with them? You'll have to either make it a ghost town or you'll have to destroy it completely. So that itself is a loss. Point number 20. Now listen to this carefully. Point number 20. Expo post-COVID, if they were to bid for Expo, let's say after COVID was over, that would be good. Why? Because after COVID is over, people would be dying. They would be desperate to have a get-together. They would be desperate to have an event, a function, something worthwhile. So post-COVID, having Expo 2020 is a good thing. If you bid for Expo 2020 today, and it happens after 2-3 years, still okay, not bad. It would be questionable, but still there would be a positive spin that yes, considering you're bidding for it today, there can be chances things can improve. And the bidding process would be not too expensive. But Expo 2020 was bid before COVID even existed. And it was bid during the boom period. It was bid during the time where everyone thought impossible is nothing. You can do whatever you want. And whatever Dubai touches will turn to gold. Why do you think they purchased so many A380s? Why do you think they built Al Maktoum International Airport? Why do you think they launched Bawardi City and 10-kilometer long hotels, only hotels, VIP casinos and 5-star hotels and all that? Because this COVID was booked and bid for before something like COVID ever existed. Sorry, Expo 2020 was bid for that. But now, what do? You're stuck with it. You're stuck with a plan, an expense, a speculation, an anticipation before when things are positive. So this in itself is a disaster. And last, if not the least, the final point is, what is UAE's priority right now? Let's assume UAE didn't have Expo 2020. Let's assume that never existed. If that didn't exist and today UAE had nothing, what do you think it would be its priority? They would say, okay, we need to pay off the $21 billion loan. We need to ensure that COVID is under control. We need to ensure that jobs are there present. We need to ensure the economy is made strong. The last thing on their mind, the last thing, would be, let's have a global event and force people to travel, force people to come, even though nobody wants to come. That would be the last thing, because when you're already in trouble, why do you want to take on more responsibility? That would be UAE's priority. But like they say, you'll pay the price for the sins of the father. UAE took on a project which was, far ahead of its time. It shouldn't have taken that project. That project itself was a curse, bidding for it. And it's like things didn't get better, things only got worse. And COVID was nothing but the final, like they say, the final nail in the coffin. So ask yourself, when the priority itself is something else and you're forcing yourself to take your resources, take your manpower, take your money and do something else which is not going to give you any returns other than just saving your face? Does that help? So overall, these are the 21 reasons why I feel Expo 2020, when you calculate all this, all these reasons together, Expo 2020 is nothing but a failure. It's a mistake. It's a really big, bad, ugly, terrible mistake, which they shouldn't have taken. And my gut feeling and prediction is they will have it, they will run it, and then they'll just not talk about it. The only thing they're going to say is, it was a grand success. We did it. We completed it despite all odds. So many people came. They'll simply inflate the numbers. They will show everyone happy, happy, positive. And then in the end, they're just going to keep quiet and wonder. It just was a mistake that we did. We got it over with. Let's move on. Let's not talk about it. So this is what I feel is with regards to Expo 2020, the 21 reasons why Expo 2021 is going to be an utter failure, a disaster of epic proportions. So check the points. Let me know what you agree with, what you disagree with. Love to hear from you. It's me signing off. You guys take care.